what is the NFPA? The NFPA is an organization of people within the fire industry that have worked on a code, which then is adopted by, I believe, all of the states, although in different forms. Some states will be in 2007, some are going to be in 2010, some have hybrided. So in every state, you're going to have to see how the NFPA has been adopted within that jurisdiction. We're going to get a little bit to DOD afterwards. DOD has their own standards, which then reference back to NFPA, but in some cases are different. Intelligibility. What's intelligibility? Definitions in 7.2 are in Chapter 3. So whenever we get into something and we say, what does that mean? Our starting point generally is Chapter 3. Okay. Intelligibility, the quality or condition of being intelligible. Sounds a little circular, but it makes sense in lieu of the next one, which is our real definition. Capable of being understood, comprehensible, and clear, which has the benefit of being one of the few things you'll ever see in the law, which is comprehensible and clear. So. After Chapter 3, you know, people call up and say, okay, well, where in the code do I find a requirement for intelligibility? And the first place that you find it on the requirements side is in Chapter 14. Okay. You've got the citations right here in the book. So afterwards, when someone calls you up and you're like, where do I find that in the code? Open your class book here, go over to 14.4.13, if you're in 2010. And I've kind of highlighted just the key words here. Voice communication shall be verified as being intelligible. Okay, shall, mandatory. When the code says may, you've got a decision to make. When it says shall, you don't, unless it comes within one of the exceptions, which we'll discuss. All right. Which brings us over to Chapter 18. One of the major changes that occurred within 2010 was this concept of acoustically distinguishable spaces. And there was a lot of confusion as to what do we have to measure. So within the code, we came on in and we said, fine, let's break the areas down into essentially zones. And then let's define whether or not that zone is going to require intelligibility. Now, this is going to happen at the design stage. As you look at this blueprint on the building, the first thing you're doing here, you're starting to sit here and say, okay, where are my ADSs? What am I going to break out as these acoustically distinguished spaces? And within Annex D, there's a lot of description of how to do that, and we'll cover some of that. But once again, let's just look at the underlined language here. Where voice intelligibility is required, system shall reproduce messages with voice intelligibility. Now we know what voice intelligibility means. We read the definition. It's got to be clear. And how we measure it and prove it, we're going to get to later. So this is kind of the next piece in the puzzle. So there's kind of this flow right within the code. It's not that bad. When you start to take some of the words out, it comes on in, it says it shall be intelligible. It starts to talk about where it's going to be intelligible, okay? And then, you know, the requirement that it shall be intelligible within those spaces. When we get over to Chapter 21, okay. Key one here, look down at point 12. Shall be verified by an operational test at the time of system acceptance. Okay, so we have to do a test, and before that system is accepted, if intelligibility is required, then it's the ability to maintain intelligible communications. So now we're into Chapter 24 here. Okay, emergency communication systems. Okay. Emergency communication systems shall be capable. Messages with voice intelligibility, in accordance with Chapter 18 that we just looked at.